If you've tried to buy a Raspberry Pi recently, you'll have noticed that that is something that's actually quite hard to do right now. For example, the common 4GB Raspberry Pi 4 that used to sell for around 50 bucks, the cheapest offer that actually has them in stock now is starting to demand scalper prices closer to 100 bucks. So if you want to run OctoPrint and still need a quality power supply and a USB cable, webcam and SD card, you could end up spending closer to 150 bucks. But what if I told you that there is a cheaper way? What if you could run OctoPrint on your old Android phone that you've got sitting around anyway? Or in fact, you can easily buy a brand new phone or tablet for what you'd be spending for a single Raspberry Pi right now. And that is already going to come with a power brick, USB cable, and a much better camera built in than what you're going to get with any webcam. And that's also going to give you a way of controlling OctoPrint without pulling out an additional device. You can control it right on the phone screen. So today we're going to try out Octo 4A, which lets you run a full OctoPrint setup, including plugin support and everything, on pretty much any Android phone. And the only thing you need is a USB adapter like this for 5 bucks. And you know what else you can get for 5 bucks? A custom PCB or professionally 3D printed parts from JLC PCB, who are sponsoring today's video. This is the latest PCB that I designed and ordered from them. And as always, I got it with the option of having all the SMD components already populated, since they charge no fixed fees for that. And then I soldered in my own through-hole parts and modules that I can move between projects. But JLC PCB are now also rolling out a 3D printing service where you can get parts printed in one of two super reasonably priced engineering resins, sintered out of PA12 or in full color nylon. So whether you are looking to add a precision printed case to your projects or just need some functional parts sintered, check out JLC PCB service at the link in the description below. So for today's test, I'm not going to use my daily Pixel 5 because I don't want that to be tied to a printer for hours at a time. Instead, I'm going to be using this Xiaomi Poco F2 Pro that I had previously. It's too big for my hands. And, you know, but it's still got an 8-core processor clocking up to almost 3 gigahertz, as well as 8 gigs of RAM. So it's easily faster than any Raspberry Pi. Unfortunately, it was the second Xiaomi phone that just randomly died on me. This one simply doesn't charge anymore, but it's otherwise technically fine. Thankfully, we can pretty easily work around the broken charge feature on the Poco F2 Pro, so let's do that real quick. The back is already off, so all I have to do is to take off the plastic shroud and unsnap the connectors like little Legos, and then solder in a little lithium-ion charger PCB directly to the battery terminals on the back. If you're going to attempt something like this, please make sure you know what you're doing or ask someone who does, because shorting out or damaging a lithium cell like this can go catastrophically wrong pretty easily. So here we go, a perfectly usable Xiaomi Poco F2. I mean, I guess you could use it like that. It's already abominably unwieldy as is. As a second phone, for reference as to how old and how weak of a phone you can still use, I'm also going to throw in this Google Samsung Galaxy Nexus. Look at how tiny this thing is. This thing is from 2011. It has a 1.2 gigahertz dual core processor and 1 gigabyte of RAM. Performance-wise, it should be roughly comparable with a Raspberry Pi 2, which already isn't exactly recommended hardware for running OctoPrint, especially once you start running plugins. And as a middle ground, I'm also going to chuck in an LG G6, which was already a very affordable phone when brand new, but you can now get them used for next to nothing. 2.something gigahertz quad core, 4 gigs of RAM. This should be about comparable or actually a bit faster than a Raspberry Pi 4. So next up, the question is, of course, how do you actually connect to your printer? Because these phones, you know, they don't exactly have a USB port that you can plug stuff into. Except that they do. So Android phones generally support what's called USB OTG, USB on the go. So with a simple adapter like this one, you can turn the USB port on the phone into a full-sized and fully featured USB host port. You can actually plug all sorts of stuff into this port, including USB hubs, thumb drives, card readers, webcams, Ethernet adapters, whatever you want, basically. So this is really just a simple plug-and-play operation. Plug in the adapter, you plug in whatever device you want, and, you know, you're good. That also works. But you may have noticed a little challenge with that. how do you keep your device charged? Because as is, you're taking up the only option of supplying power to the phone with the built-in USB port. With the Poco, of course, we have conveniently already worked around that by completely bypassing the charging circuit. But for normal devices, you can get either a little Y cable like this for about $5 that gives you the USB host port, but it also lets you plug in your regular charger. Make sure the cable you're getting actually supports charging the phone. Some just supply power to the device you're connecting. For new devices with a USB-C port, thanks to laptops not having ports anymore, you can pretty easily find these dongle adapters now for about $10, which again give you the host port, which you want, a USB-C power delivery charge port, and often also HDMI, which is probably not going to work on a phone. But you can also get them with a wired Ethernet port built in if you don't want to rely on Wi-Fi, or you can use a USB hub with a port built in. These Ethernet ports will work on an Android phone. Alternatively, for supplying power, you could also use a wireless charging puck and fasten your phone to that somehow, but I have a feeling that that just isn't the best solution overall. Since we're going to be using the phone's built-in camera as a webcam, we also need some way to mount it in a convenient location. And you can totally print a mount or use whatever solution you already have for the webcam that you would be mounting. But I took a quick look through my camera rigging bin and picked out this super clamp, magic arm, and spring-loaded phone mount, and I can now position this however I want. I'm putting all the affiliate links to this stuff in the video description below, by the way, if you're interested. Okay, so that is the hardware covered. Let's move on to software, and this is actually the easy part. All you've got to do is download the APK for Octo4A from GitHub and install it. An APK is essentially an installer file for Android. Now, your phone is going to ask you whether you actually want to install this. The thing is, typically, you get your Android apps from the Google Play Store, but because of the way that Octo4A works, it can't actually be distributed through the Play Store. Now, there, the apps are at least somewhat checked for whether they do malicious stuff or not. If you sideload an APK, you're not getting any of those checks anymore, and it's essentially the same as running some software you downloaded onto your Windows, Mac, Linux, BSD, Solaris, or TempleOS computer. I've written a couple of emails with Philippe, who makes Octo4A, and he seems like a nice guy, but just in case it turns out that he isn't, don't blame me. Octo4A is free open source software, so while that's not a guarantee that the APK is good too, it's a very good sign at least. Once you've installed and opened up Octo4A, it's going to pull a fresh version of all the files that OctoPrint needs to run, as well as OctoPrint itself. There are a couple of things that you can and still should configure before you start diving into OctoPrint. So head over to the Settings tab and hit
Install Plugin Extras.
Plugins like Octolabs need some extra files to run, and if you don't click this thing, you're going to get an issue when you try to install Octolabs. Next, head down and configure your camera. I like to use a 1920x1080 resolution while limiting the FPS to 15. This is going to save a lot of bandwidth and processing power, but you still get a really crisp image for checking your prints. Oh, when did I knock this one over? And, you know, 1080p is really great for time lapses. One thing that I got sometimes is that when I had the phone in portrait mode and then rotated it into landscape while Octo4A was already running, it would actually show a portrait crop of your frame. So when you set up your phone, orient it correctly and then turn on the camera server in Octo4A. If you want, you can also enable start on boot or even turn on SSH access into the OctoPrint environment, but you're probably not even going to need that. In any case, you can open up your favorite browser on your computer, point it to the address and port that Octo4A shows you, and you should get the OctoPrint interface we all know and love. Now, honestly, from here on out, the setup is basically the same as with a regular OctoPrint install on a Raspberry Pi. Go through the setup assistant, pick a password, etc. Like I said, it's a full-featured version. It can run plugins, you can do time lapses, all of that. So for the rest of the setup, jump over to my latest video on OctoPrint, which I'm going to link to at the end of this video. For now, there are a couple more details that we're going to need to address in Android so that Octo4A and OctoPrint actually run reliably. So the first thing is adjusting energy saving options. Especially new devices with custom Android builds, like you know the Xiaomi devices, have very aggressive power saving measures once the screen turns off. So what can happen is that Octo4A and with it OctoPrint just get completely suspended, which, as you might guess, isn't great when it's actually running a print. Where exactly you're going to find those settings is going to depend on your exact device, but make sure to check through the app list and check the settings for OctoPrint. Make sure it's set to unlimited battery use and not to optimized or anything like that. Then go in through the battery menu point and settings, and again, make sure to turn off any adaptive, optimized, or smart options for the whole device. And also check specifically for Octo4A again. And then if your device has some manufacturer-specific smart-ass assistant settings menu, that can often also hide some more power settings that could mess things up. Octo4A also automatically asks you if you want to change one of the settings to allow it to always run in the background, and you should definitely press allow here. The next screen to open up battery settings doesn't really do anything yet for me, but if you dug through the menus like we've just talked about and change everything you could, you should be good here. But if you still run into issues with too aggressive power management, you could try enabling the options to always leave the screen on while the phone is plugged in, which you can do in the Android develop options. But keep in mind that if your phone has an OLED screen, these two have, this guy has an LCD, because the phone is always going to leave the screen on, it's probably going to have some pretty nasty burn-in after just a couple weeks of use. So if you make use of that option, at least set the screen to minimal brightness. So what is it like to actually use OctoPrint running on a phone? Well, it's about as expected. Let's start with performance. I tested how long it takes to upload a larger 60 megabyte G-code file to get a general sense of how well things are working. And there are some real differences. The Poco F2, being the device with the most raw horsepower, finishes first at just 3 seconds until the upload is complete. The LG G6 and Raspberry Pi 4 come in at 10 and 11 seconds, which is slower, yes, but still perfectly usable, while the Galaxy Nexus takes 2 minutes and 30 seconds. I mean, if you're just using your Slice's background upload and then have the print auto start, that's probably fine still, but unless you're just printing small, simple parts, if you do it manually, it's probably going to be very annoying and painful in the long run. All of this was tested 2 meters away from a Wi-Fi 5 access point after giving the phone and OctoPrint some time to calm down after starting up. Now, for website load times, all three phones and the Raspberry Pi were almost instantaneous, so I don't know if there's some caching going on or if OctoPrint's interface is just that well optimized, but you still feel the difference in how long, for example, the settings menus take to save, and just in just general UI snappiness. Now, all of this might not have disqualified the Galaxy Nexus yet, but because it's also running a rather old version of Android, Cyanogen mod with Android 4.4, the entire experience is rather buggy too. I did get the camera feed working and the printer connected at the same time once, but between the app crashing, not seeing the printer's USB interface, or just generally weirding out, it just wasn't fun to use. But hey, this thing is 10 years old. I feel like anything just a bit newer, or the newest version of Lineage OS, which is Android 7, I believe, would actually work. And if you look at the experience you're getting with the 4.5-year-old LG G6 and the Poco F2 Pro from last year, it's pretty much flawless in both of these. The only thing that I could find is that with the Poco, you can't use these simple passive adapters. You have to use a dongle like this with the power plugged in. The G6 works without the power plugged in, the Poco doesn't, but that might be down to the broken charge circuit. But you know, once you figure that out, it's literally just like any other OctoPrint install. The interface is snappy, it's reliable, you know, it printed just fine actually. Plugins work, and with stuff like Octolabs now having access to the phone's main camera, you can actually get some really crispy time lapses through that. It's a really good experience. I tried if there would be hiccups when you do stuff in the UI or upload files while the print is going, but it's just really smooth everywhere. And as a bonus, you can even open up a browser on the phone itself, point it to localhost port 5000, and you get the full OctoPrint interface, or a mobile-friendly one if you use the Touch UI plugin. You could even use a tablet and just have that be your main printed touchscreen. I think Octo4A is a really good solution, to the point where honestly, if you're just looking to get OctoPrint running, I would rather buy a cheap Android phone now than mess around with the Pi, you know, printing a case for that, trying different USB cable options because they aren't reliable and so on. Octo4A works well, it's pretty easy to set up, and in the best case, you don't even have to buy anything for it and give a second life to a used device. I like that. And if you like that too, make sure to support OctoPrint and Octo4A. They're projects that give away their work for free, so show them some appreciation if you find them useful. Of course, I'd also appreciate a thumbs up on the video, but hey, I'm just the messenger this time. Thanks for watching, keep on making, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye!